If you recall, or if you saw the previous video in the sourdough journey, I was creating a sourdough starter using organic fruit and beginning a process which will allow us to harvest yeast and lactobacillus from the exterior of that fruit. And in the particular case of that video, it's blueberries. They are currently underway, and the water is looking pretty good at this point. But I also mentioned that I wanted to go back to one of the sourdough cultures, or the company that produces cultures, that I've used in the past. And this is from Ed Wood's Sourdoughs International, or International Sourdoughs. This is a Yukon culture. It's a 1 ounce sample. You can see that they've just taken a culture that originates from the Yukon region. They've dehydrated it and allowed it to go dormant, or forced it to go dormant, and then packaged it within some wheat flour. And this is a 1 ounce package, 28 grams. It arrived at my house within 10 days or so of ordering online. And along with that, they send a set of instructions for how to rehydrate and reactivate the starter. This is essentially just about a three-step process. They say it takes about 3 to 5 days for your starter to fully activate and be good for use, which, if you've ever started your own sourdough starter, it can take quite some time before you really develop a good, strong culture that's going to leaven your dough, as well as a lactobacillus colony or community that's going to give you that really nice sour flavor. This, in my opinion, is one of the best ways to just hit the ground running. You're good to go within a week. I think, honestly, based upon my previous experience, this should be ready to use within 3 days, maybe within two, depending on, the strength of the culture that's included here. My previous experience was with the Italian and French cultures, which blew my mind with their flavor. I cannot say enough good things about the quality of those sourdough cultures, and highly recommend, if you want to get into this realm and experiment a little bit, hit up Sourdoughs International. I'll put a link in the description, and you'll be well on your way to producing like professional quality sourdough, so long as you just follow some really basic steps and, most importantly, employ patience, because this is all about the waiting game. Unlike a commercial dry active yeast, which is going to leaven your bread very quickly, doesn't really produce a whole lot of flavor in and of itself, sourdough is kind of like the exact opposite. It takes time, it's going to be a much longer process, but the reward is definitely worth your investment of time. So just a really quick overview of what they have here laid out in the instructions. They state that it's in a dormant stage and needs to be fully activated before use. They recommend using a proofing box, which is more or less a box which is temperature controlled, humidity controlled in some cases, and allows you to create an environment where the starter is going to thrive. The initial step here is to take your 1 ounce culture, which is being integrated into some wheat flour, add it into the container such as this. They say use about a 1 quart size jar, a glass canning jar with a wide mouth so there's easy access, since we'll be constantly removing starter, which is called discard, and re-adding starter in during the feed process. So you definitely want to use a wide mouth container. And I have kind of lucked out at Goodwill at one point, and I got these really nice wide mouth ceramic, yeah, I believe it's some sort of ceramic or porcelain jar, but it doesn't have a super tight fitting lid. It has a nice little like plastic gasket that sits around the lid. It won't allow anything large to get inside, but it will allow some air to escape. This, in my opinion, is absolutely perfect. I can just let it hang out here on my countertop. Or if I want a slightly warmer environment to speed up the feeding process, and I'll cover this a little bit more detail in future videos, but if you want the yeast to feed faster, you increase the temperature. If you want it to feed slower, you decrease the temperature. My oven, just through some investigation and experimentation, if I just flip on my oven light, the light inside heats up to 130 or 140 degrees, which will end up raising the temperature of the oven itself to somewhere between 90 and 100 degrees. So they recommend this first step, which is going to elapse over the first 24 hours of mixing our culture, some flour and water, put that in a heated environment right around 90 degrees for that 24 hours, and then you'll continue the regular feeding process at what would be like a typical room temperature of 70 to 75 degrees Fahrenheit, or right around 21, 22 Celsius. I have already measured out what is 3/4 cups of water and flour, which equates to just about 160 grams of water and right around 100 grams of flour. One of the most critical parts of baking is proper measurements. So, quick tip, get yourself a scale that's accurate and ideally is going to measure in grams. I prefer grams because it's more granular as opposed to ounces. But whatever you're comfortable with. Most of the recipes I tend to see online are in grams, so that's why I lean toward grams. Don't have to do any sort of conversion or anything like that. So as I said, about 100 grams of flour, 160 grams of water. Our culture itself is 1 ounce, which is just about 28 or 30 grams. All we're gonna do here is add the water, pop open our culture, and it's literally just wheat flour. This looks like regular flour, but they've incorporated part of that sourdough culture into the flour. And then we will add the rest of our flour there. This is a Danish dough whisk. I really like using this for mixing in certain situations. Picked it up on Amazon for like 15 bucks or so. It's Cosom, C-O-S-O-N. Quality's decent. I was baking like 4 to 5 times a week sometimes, multiple doughs each time I would bake, and had some durability issues with the top part disconnecting from the base, but ultimately was able to sort that out with a little bit of repair using some glue. Other than that, yeah, these are fantastic for mixing dough if you're going to be working by hand. I don't actually have a stand mixer or automatic mixer, so everything I do is by hand. Once we mix this up, it should be just about the consistency of pancake batter. You don't want to overmix it because what that's going to do is begin the gluten development, and all we're trying to do is roughly mix our dry and wet ingredients together to get the process started. It's really that simple. The first step mix the ingredients together. We're going to let this hang out. The yeast and lactobacillus are going to begin to feed. It's going to smooth out over the course of the next 24 hours and then end up producing some bubbles, which are an indication that the yeast is feeding and producing that CO2, which is going to leaven our bread. A general rule of thumb when it comes to just ultimately maintaining your starter is at the end of that 24 hours, I'm going to take half of this out and place it into my jar here. So what I like to do is I like to have or maintain a starter that's right around 250 grams. So it will be just about half of this. If we take the 160 grams of water plus 100 grams of flour, that's 260, plus the 30 grams or so of starter that we add. So that brings us up to 290 grams, right around 300. So if we divide that in half, it's 150. So I'm gonna take right around 150 grams of this starter after 24 hours and transfer it over to my final container or resting place and home for the starter. At that point, you could take the other half and just throw it away as discard, or you could make another starter. Take another jar, and what a lot of people will do is take that secondary jar and put it in their fridge. Because as I mentioned before, the temperature at which a yeast or starter is held or stored is going to determine how quickly it feeds. So right around 75 degrees is your optimum normal temperature for yeast feeding. If I increase that by 15 degrees to 90, it's going to feed twice as fast. If I decrease the temperature by 15 degrees, it's going to make the starter feed half as fast. So if I'm storing this at room temperature, I'm going to feed it every 24 hours or so. Over the course of that 24 hours, if you peek in here and look at it, you'll see it starts to expand up and then it'll begin to drop back down. It drops down once that culture has fed on all of the available sugars and nutrients in the fresh flour as part of the previous feeding. If I put it in the fridge, that's going to extend the time between feedings up to 5 to 7 days. Maybe even more. So as a backup, and this is probably something you want to do if you're investing money and time into getting a good quality starter, you'll want to have a starter that hangs out at room temperature, something that you can use often if you do plan on baking, you know, within 5 days of it, each other. Like I said, I was baking like almost every day for a while. So I had a starter out on my countertop that I would feed literally every single day. And then I had a clone of that in my fridge, which I would feed about once a week. And the one that's in your fridge is kind of like a safety net. So if for whatever reason I neglect the starter that's out on my countertop, if I don't have time to feed it at that regular daily interval and it ends up going bad, I can just revert back to what's in the fridge. So highly recommended you have that safety net, but it's not required. Going back to what happens after the first 24 hours of this being mixed together, again, I take out about 150 grams, put it into my jar, and then I add in another 150 grams total of flour and water together. So let's think about this for a moment. I have 150 grams of a flour-water mixture in my jar, and I want to double that in size. So I need to add 75 grams of water and 75 grams of flour. What that's going to do is allow us to maintain the same consistency of the starter, and you're just feeding it equal parts water and flour pretty much for the rest of the life cycle of your starter, which could be forever. Your starter, if people, if you maintain it properly, and if other people in your life so desire, this starter could definitely outlive you. It just needs that constant attention and love and care. So that'll bring me up to about 300 grams of starter. And I like to have, as I mentioned before, around 240, 250 grams at all times in here, because a typical loaf of bread is going to use about 100 and, or somewhere between 100 and 120 grams of starter. So I can, at a feed interval, if I'm going to feed my starter, which involves taking half of it out and throwing it down the drain, that's why we call it discard. You want to remove part of the culture, discard it, throw it away, and then replace that half with fresh water and fresh flour. But let's say I go to feed my starter and I decide I'm going to make a loaf of bread that day. Well, what I can do is take what would normally be discard that I throw down the drain, and I use that as my base for my loaf of bread. Or waffles. I'll get into that at a later date. So this may seem a little weird or strange, like it's called discard, but if you want to use it, it becomes extremely valuable, because that's what your the base of your loaf of bread is going to be. I hope this makes sense. It's not as complicated as maybe I'm making it out to be. But that daily feed cycle is just going to continue throughout the lifetime of the starter itself. Just to reiterate, we have our fresh mixture of 160-ish grams of water, 100 grams of flour, 30-ish grams of starter, which came in our package from Sourdough's International. We let this rest 24 hours. We should see some activity, some bubbles, which is an indication that the yeast is producing CO2. It's feeding on that fresh water and flour that we provided it with in order to rehydrate and revive the culture that was in that sample. At the end of that 24 hours, transfer half of that contents into our home for the starter, and then we feed it just as we did the first time, at the beginning of that 24-hour cycle, with water and flour, equal parts. If I'm putting 150 grams of this starter that I'm trying to revive into my jar, I want to add 75 grams of water and 75 grams of flour, which will give us a total weight of about 300 grams that we now can give some sort of name. I am pretty generic with my naming at times. I just labeled this one Yukon, so I know what it is, because I have another culture from Bahrain, which is just hanging out in the fridge. I'm not going to start that one just yet. But as a rule of thumb, additionally, you should always name your starter. Treat it like your baby. It's going to provide for you and bring a lot of joy to your life if you're successful in your baking endeavors. Again, please like, share, subscribe if you find this content valuable, and if you have other folks in your life who may benefit from this process. And happy baking. We'll get more into some actual recipes and utilizing the starter in probably just a few days. I will I'll probably come back here and show you what this looks like after the first feeding or two, and give you a little bit of an update on how the starter is coming along. But I fully anticipate that I can start baking with this within 3 to 5 days without a problem.